show you this one. I just want to start with this. I wasn't going to start with this, but I want to go to Galatians chapter 3, verse 1. Galatians chapter number 3 and verse 1. And what's interesting, if, for those of you that know, the book of Galatians is dealing with what error? Does anybody know? Galatianism, the Galatian heresy. It's the error that was mixing law with grace. Thank you, Joel. It's the error that was mixing law with grace. Law with grace. And what this does to people is it causes them not to see what Jesus did. But I want to show you something. And the point I'm after here is the power that's in God's Word. The power that's in God's Word. One of the old timers said the reason that many believers struggle with the word, receiving the Word and believing the Word, or many people in general, is because their own Word doesn't mean anything.
Come on.
Amen? It's the truth. And well, anyhow, I want to show you this. King James, please. There's a reason. I love the Amplified there because he says, "Oh, foolish and unreflecting, senseless and unreflecting Galatians." The Amplified says, unreflecting. We need to be reflecting, and we're going to get into that. We're going to talk about what does it mean to be a doer of the Word of God. Amen?
Amen.
I can tell you're excited. You know the key to this whole thing is stay in the Word. And if you're not in the Word, get into the Word. Because you're listening to somebody's Word all the time. Did you know that?
Right.
You're listening to the Word of your own thoughts, your own conscience, many times that's sin conscious. You're listening to the words of other people. You're constantly hearing words. You're constantly speaking them and hearing them. Your heart, when your heart begins to believe that God cannot lie, your soul's going to be anchored and not going to be so unstable.
Amen.
Amen. Now watch this. Oh, foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you, cast a spell upon you. There's so many things we could say here, but I'm just after one thing. That you should not obey the truth. Obey the truth. Isn't that interesting? See, legalistic people hear that and say, obey rules. That's not what it's saying.
Right.
It's saying, follow the truth. The truth is in Christ. He is the truth, the way, the truth, and the life. His word is truth. We're going to see that. Before whose eyes Jesus Christ hath been evidently set forth, crucified among you. When it says, hath evidently set before you, you know what's fascinated me when I looked at this word in the Greek? Fascinated me. It's prographo. Prographo. Grapho is related to graphe, which is the word that's translated scripture throughout the New Testament. And when it says, here's what he, pro is a preposition that means before. Everybody say before.
Before.
And he's saying, here's how you've seen Jesus, through the writings, the scriptures. That's what he's saying. I always would look at this and say, wow, did they see Jesus crucified physically? He's saying, no, you see him in the Word. Mm-hmm.
Amen?
Let me show you, this is a little off trail, but we'll jump over to Romans 13, 14. I want to show you that little preposition, pro, which means before. So you start understanding things. It says, but put you on the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, how do you put on Jesus? Put on his word. Amen?
Amen.
The written word reveals the living word.
That's right.
Without the written word, you cannot accurately see the living word. That's why there's such a battle against the word. That's where the battle's at. It's not because you're so great or I'm so great. It's because the Word. The devil fears the Word getting rooted in our heart. He don't care if we do activities. He don't care if we do different things. He doesn't care. All he's concerned about is that the Word does not take root in your heart or my heart. All right, now watch. But it says, put you on the Lord Jesus Christ. Make not provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof. Do you know what that word provision is in the Greek? Pronoia. Pro, can you hear it? Before, everybody say before.
Before.
And noia, which comes from nois, which is where we get the word for mind or intellect. This word is actually saying, how do you make provision for the flesh? You take forethought for it. You're not focused on the word. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So what's the key? Put on Jesus. Put on the word. And guess what? You won't take forethought for the flesh. You know, when people are depressed, it's because they're thinking wrong. Change your thoughts, you change your feelings. God said, Isaiah said, Isaiah 26, 3, God will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed upon him. Because he trusts in thee. How do you trust in him? You keep your focus on him.
Amen.
And what he did. That's the fight, my friend.
That's it.
All right, now here we go. Start with the lesson. Everybody say the word.
The word.
Word is powerful. We need the word. Okay, go to James chapter 1, verse 22. James chapter 1 and verse number 22. Oh, this gets good. I wrote some Greeky stuff here for you, because I'm a Greeky kind of guy. Koine Greek. Amen. The common language. All right. But be doers of the word. Leave this verse up here. We're going to marinate in it for a little bit. We're going to talk about what is a doer of the word. Here's what most people think. They think, oh, just be a doer of the word. I got to do something. No, that's not what it's saying. If you read it in context, he'll show you what a doer. Now, and the Greek really brings it out. But be doers of the word and not hearers only, or the devil will deceive you. Deceiving your own selves. Now notice what we're to be doing. First of all, the word, the logos, God's word, not man's word. You know, I get real concerned when people have all kinds of books and things, but it's not founded in the word of God. Amen?
Amen.
You know, I'll give you one example from my own life. Who's ever heard of dream interpretation? You know what I think of dream interpretation? If you don't know what it means, throw it out.
Amen.
Stick with the word.
Amen.
I got the book. I got one of the books. You know, this means that and this means that. If God doesn't show you what it means, throw it out.
Amen.
You're led by the Spirit of God. You're in the new covenant, not in the old covenant. Most of the verses they use are pulling it from the old covenant. They didn't have what you and I have. You're led by the Word of God and the Spirit of God, and He's in you. And if you don't know what it means, then throw it away. But yet we buy all these books, and I'm thinking they have different scriptures, but where's it at in the Word? The Word is your safeguard.
Amen.
Now, I'm going to come right back here. I want you to jump over one place, 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 4. I want to show you this. I want to show you this, and I'm going to... Chronicles. Go to 2 Corinthians. There we go. For if he that cometh, now leave this up here, preacheth another Jesus. Now wait a minute. There's only one true Jesus, right?
Right.
Correct. But he's saying, this is talking about a counterfeit.
Mm-hmm.
A counterfeit. You know people can receive a counterfeit Jesus? Amen? Many people do. But I'm going to show you what it looks like. I'm going to show you how it works. For he that comes preaches another or proclaims another Jesus whom we have not preached, or if you receive another spirit which ye have not received, or another gospel, and there's only one true gospel, right?
Right.
Which ye have not accepted, you put up with it is what that means. You might well bear with him, or you put up with that. But here's what I want you to see. Look at the first word, another. Look at the second word, another. And look at the third, another. In Greek, the second two, another and another, for spirit and gospel, I've told you this before, it's the Greek word heteros. Everybody say heteros.
Heteros.
It means another of a different kind. Another of a different kind. Another of a different kind. Not the same kind. But the one in front of Jesus is alos. Say alos. Alos, which means another of the same kind. Which means this Jesus that people proclaim, there's a lot of right things they're saying. Correct? But it's not the true, one true Jesus of the Bible. Now watch, how does this happen? I'm going to read you a post I wrote because it says it well. The first step, everybody say the first, in creating another Jesus or a counterfeit Jesus is to separate Jesus, the living word, from the written word or the scriptures. That's the first step. Now watch this. Without allowing the Holy Spirit to reveal the living word, Jesus, through the pages of the written word, Scripture, it becomes very easy to create a God in one's own image. You know how one way you can tell if you're being led of the Spirit? I'll show it to you. Go to John chapter 16, verse 13. You know, this is one of the major ways. I hear people saying all the time, God told me, God told me. You do too. I've said it too. But if it don't line up with the Word, well, I don't know what the Word says. So right there's your problem.
Yeah.
You need to know what the Word says. Can I say this with me? Say deception,
deception.
Is no respecter of persons.
No respecter.
In fact, it goes harder after believers because deception neutralizes the body of Christ. Amen? Deception takes all of your confidence away when you pray. because you're not putting faith in his word. Now watch this. Howbeit when he, now the Spirit of God has come now. This is Jesus speaking before the cross. And he's telling, when he, the Spirit of truth, everybody say the Spirit of truth.
Spirit.
That's the Holy Spirit. When he has come, he will guide you into all truth. Now, I'm not going to go there for the sake of time, but John 17, 17, Jesus said, sanctify or set them apart through thy word. Thy word is truth. Jesus is the word, John 1, 1, right? Now watch this, but sanctify them, set them apart through thy word. Thy word is truth. Once again, you cannot separate the living word from the written word or you're ripe for deception. We need to be grounded in the Word of God. That's what Satan fights. Do you know if you stay in the Word of God, I don't know how long it'll take, but I guarantee you, you will bring forth fruit.
Amen.
Guarantee. See, people want the blessing of God, but we bring forth fruit with patience, the Bible says in Hebrews 6:12. Also, Luke chapter 8, verse 15. I think it's in an honest good and good heart. I think it's verse 15. They bring forth fruit. We're going to talk about that. What brings forth fruit? The word in your heart sown.
Amen.
Well, I tried that, and I tried that for a couple years, and it didn't work. I always tell people, Jesus is not a pair of shoes that you try. If you get the word of God in your heart, guaranteed you'll change in a positive way. Guaranteed. You'll look back and think, my word, I'm not even the same person. But all right, hang on. Howbeit when he, the Spirit of truth, the Holy Spirit has come, he will guide you into all truth, for he shall not speak of himself. The word of literally means, is the word apo. Everybody say apo. It's a preposition that he will not speak away from himself. That's what he's saying. But whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he shall show you things to come. Amen? You know one of the ways to tell that if you're being led of the Spirit? The word is truth. Are you being guided into the word or away from the word? Well, I don't know the word. Once again, we're trying to fix that, but we can't fix it. Can I tell you something else? You know, I was talking to a guy just recently, and we were on the subject of youth ministry and all that kind of stuff, and everybody wants the church to wave the magic wand. You know why? You know where ministry starts with your children? At home. Well, I can't get him to read the Bible. Do you read the Bible? Amen. Come on, man. I know kids are different and God was the perfect father. I'm not talking about that, but I'm trying to encourage you. We have to, you know, if I only live it at church and I only live it when I'm away from home, then what are my children seeing? Amen. All right. So when he will guide you. So you can tell if you're being led of the Spirit. Is it into the Word or away from the Word? And even when he leads you in situations, it will always be through the Word. Never away from the Word. Never away. You know, in the very beginning, and I'm not going to go there, in Genesis chapter 3, when the serpent, the devil, tempted Eve, you know the first thing he cast doubt on God's Word. He said, hath God said? You know it's the same thing today? You know the law first mentioned? Theologians talk about that. Whenever a major subject's introduced in Scripture, the characteristic and the attributes that are assigned to that subject are consistent throughout the rest of the Word. The first time the devil's mentioned, he was more subtle than all the beasts of the field, the serpent. The devil was more subtle, so it's subtlety. And the first thing he did was cast doubt on God's Word. It's the same thing today. I made a decision recently. I'm going to kick up the word in my life. I said, Chris, you're already nuts in a good way. I'm telling you, I'm blown away by the goodness of God. God is so good. And it's not, oh, yeah, you got a new this or a new that. It's not about that. And you know, those things can happen, and that's fine. It's about what's going on in my heart. You know the key? You'll see it on the inside before you ever see it on the outside. You know, I sit there sometime and I think, God's called us to touch the world. And I'm up here hearing myself spout and I'm thinking, I'm standing on the outside thinking, you have lost it, dude. But you know, it's God. It's God. Don't limit the creator of the universe. In the Old Testament, they limited the Holy One of Israel. You can limit him. It's not about the earthen vessel. It's about what's in the earthen vessel. And if you think I'm excited, get ready. It's going to get worse. God is good. God is good. Amen. Now watch this. Back to James 1:22. But be ye doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving your own self. I think that's amazing that I can deceive my own self by hearing the word and never applying the word. We're going to talk about this. Now, what does it mean? First of all, be. Oh, I love this. I love this, love this, love. Genomai. Look at your neighbor and say, genomai.
Genomai.
Okay, genomai. It means be, genomai. It's in the present tense. Present tense. Continuous action with no end in sight, right? Watch this. It's in the middle voice. This means I cooperate for my benefit. And it's in the imperative mood, which means it's imperative. I need to do this or I'll deceive myself. This is why Satan loves religion. Oh, it's great, man. Just go. I did my God thing. Now go back to real life. You know, God wants to be involved in your life. Every facet. He happens to love you. He even likes you. You know what I'm learning? I'm learning more and more to like myself. God made me. Take it up with Him. Yes, He's still working. Jen gets on me. She goes, and I pray, man, if I do this again, you're free to come up and kick me. But man, this is the Word of God, and it is awesome. And she said, sometimes, Chris, when you're done, you're almost like you apologize for the Word. Well, I hope you got something. You know what that is? Self-centeredness. I just threw a post on Facebook just a little bit ago. Insecurities are a result of making it about me. Security is a result of making it about Him. And it's all about Him. And this Word is awesome. Glory to God. Hallelujah. But be doers. What's the word? Well, let me finish be, because I want to give you some of the definitions. Genomai means to become. It means to come into existence. Whoa. I love this one. It means to begin to be. Begin to be. Genomai means to start where you're at and start doing the Word. We're going to talk about what a doer is. This isn't legalism, guys. Not at all. This isn't doing to be right with God. No, 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 no. Jesus did all that. But this is allowing what God has made you begin to be who you are in Christ. Can you hear that? Can you hear that? That's awesome. Now watch this. Begin to be. It means to receive being. Receive being. Receive. Receive who I am. How? By being a doer of the Word of God. Look at the word doers. The Greek word for doers is poietes. Say that with me. Poietes. It's related to poiei, which is means to you know, to do, to produce, etc. But this word poietes is where we get our English word. Are you ready? Poet. And if you study the word, it has to do with having a creative flair. How do you become a doer of the Word of God? You have a creative flair because you're in love. You know, when in we won't go there, but in Revelation chapter 2, when he talked to the church of Ephesus, and he said, you have left your first love. The Greek says, you've lost the wonder of it all. I counsel you to buy it. Or no, I'm sorry, I jumped to Laodicea. But he said, begin to do. Everybody say, do.
Do.
And that means begin to do, just like we're talking about here. Begin to be creative in your love for God. You know, when you first started dating your husband and wife or whatever, people have like, man, they think of all kinds of things to do. Right? Because you're in the wonder of it all. You're excited. Bah, I'll tell you what, honey. We could just go skip by that stinky old sewer over there. Oh, that sounds great. I just thought of it. But you know, here's the point. You're in love. You're in love. And that's what he's saying. Be doers. Begin to have that creative flair, that relationship as you receive who you are, as you receive the love of God. This is automatic. This is automatic. Now watch this. And not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. But notice what we do. Everybody say, what do we do? The Word of God, not ours. Amen. Now moving right along. So what does this look like? Next verse. But if any man be a hearer of the word and not a doer of the word, he is like unto a man beholding his natural face in a mirror, a glass. For next verse, for he beholds himself, he looks in the mirror, and then he goes his way and straightway or immediately forgets what kind of man he was. This is what it means. This is what he's saying. This is what happens when you hear the word and you don't apply the word. You look in the mirror, you see it, and you don't apply it, and guess what? You forget it. You lose it.
That's right.
How many times have I read a scripture verse like, my word, when did God put that in the Bible? You know why? I read it many times. Because see, that's the importance of meditation and allowing the Word of God to take root in your heart. To begin to see yourself in the promise. Begin to see yourself with the blessing. I'll tell you what, I'm on a kick to not feel sorry for myself. I mean it. I'm on a crusade in my personal life, because whenever I want to get on a pity trip, I start seeing a promise. Lord, I start seeing a promise. I start seeing blessing. I start seeing favor. I start seeing God doing this. I make myself see it in my heart. When you keep your mind stayed upon the Lord, that Hebrew word for mind in Isaiah 26:3 is the same word for imagination. No, that's fairy tale stuff. We're always imagining something.
Right.
Amen. Amen? All the time.
Right.
All the time.
Right.
But see, this is what it means. We gotta when things come out of this is why we need to be marinating in the Word of God.
Yeah.
Because something's gonna produce in our life. Now, so this is why, imagine in a natural mirror, you got food on your face, you go to the mirror, you look at it, and you walk away, guess what? You forget you got food on your face. I used to do this to a guy I worked with. Denny knows about this. And he would get so mad that I loved it. So I'd take cream from the inside of a donut and I'd put it on my nose. I'd walk up and say, yeah, I know what you mean. I'd talk bigger and go, look at him. Well, that was fun. But my point is if you look in a mirror and you walk away, you forget who you are. If you look in the Word and see who you are in Christ and you don't apply who you are in Christ, you don't activate or do something with that knowledge, have that creative flair, God will show you what to do. You don't meditate in it, you'll forget it. This is why believers forget all these things.
Amen.
If anybody thinks they know the Word, I'm telling you, it's amazing. It's fathomless. I'm a very real person. And I want to be real in my heart. But I'm telling you guys, I'm really believing this healing stuff.
Amen.
It's not here anymore. It's starting to really get here. And I'm almost to the place where I'm expecting it. Well, what if it doesn't happen? I'll just keep shooting it till it does happen.
Amen.
And, I'm getting ahead of myself. This is why I want to get into covenant. Because if you don't understand covenant, which is in the Word, the Bible is a covenant book. Did you know that? And if you don't understand covenant, you will say, well, why didn't God do something? Well, if God didn't do anything or manifest anything, it's because He could not.
Amen.
God can't lie.
That's right.
But I'm getting ahead of myself. I don't want to do that. For this guy, he beholds himself, he goes his way and forgets what manner of man he was. Next verse. But whoso looketh into the perfect, complete law of liberty. Everybody say liberty.
Liberty.
That's freedom. Freedom from what? Having to measure up, like the old covenant. He looks into it. This is our work, guys. And he continues there. And he continues looking at what Jesus did in the Word. He focuses on it. He's meditating on it. What is that? Being a doer of the Word of God. Okay? Now watch this. He being not a forgetful here, but a doer of the work. What is the work? Looking into the perfect law of liberty. What must we do to work the works of God? They asked Jesus in John 6. This is the work of God, verse 29. That you believe into Him, the Greek says, whom He has sent. That's the work. See, we already believe in ourselves. The world's taught us that. You get what you deserve, right? We already believe in ourselves. What's the work? Believing in Him. Getting faith out of me and into Him. That's a work. That's what he said. But if you look into the perfect law of liberty, the new covenant, and continue looking therein, you being not a forgetful here, but a doer of that work, that man shall be blessed in what he does.
Amen.
Woo! Next verse. Look at this. Look at the next verse. If any man among you seem to be religious or have a form of worship and doesn't bridle his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, leave this up here. This man's religion is vain. Notice he brings it over to your mouth. You know where we get it mixed up at? We try to say things without being a doer of the Word of God and meditating in the promises. Well, somebody gave me a little book and they said, speak these words. That may help you sow it, but just because you say it, thank God you don't get everything you say, right?
Amen.
That's why Jesus asked him, how can you, being evil, speak good things in Matthew chapter 12? He was talking to religious leaders. For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. He says, you're not even speaking what you believe. See, we got to believe it. Then our mouth gets in line. Yes, you need to say it even when you don't feel. It's not about a feeling, guys. This is more than a feeling. Oh, sorry. But look at it says, if I don't bridle my tongue, I deceive my heart and my religion is vain. Useless. I don't like the word religion, but that's old King James. Worship, right? is vain if I don't bridle my heart. Isn't that amazing? Next verse. Pure religion and worship and undefiled before God in this. This is what it looks like when you're a doer of the word. This is manifestation of you keeping your focus in God's word. You don't have to worry about your ministry, guys. Did you know that?
That's right.
You don't have to even concern yourself with it. Just stay in the word. I got one agenda right now for my life. Stay in the word.
Amen.
And get into it even more. I tell you guys, it is life changing. I see stuff sometimes. I have to walk away. I'm walking. I got so much stuff up here. My wife was in Kroger yesterday. I stayed out in the car praying in the Holy Ghost and meditating the word. I got so much out of Hebrews chapter 6. I write on napkins. You know napkins that you wipe your face with? I got notes all over them. It's awesome, guys. This life is awesome. The Word of God is awesome in me. The Word of God is awesome in you. So I said, well, no, it's awesome in so-and-so and so-and-so. I know it's awesome in you. That's, God wants you to see that. Look at that. If pure religion, undefiled before God and the Father is this. This is what it looks like. To visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction and to keep himself unspotted from the world. What is unspotted from the world? Now, he doesn't watch any movies he shouldn't be watching. That's not what it's talking about. Don't get me wrong, you shouldn't be doing that. That's not what it's talking about. It's saying keeps him unspotted from thinking that what he's doing is earning him points with God or making somehow making him more righteous. Are you hearing me? He doesn't glory in what he's doing. He continues to glory in what Jesus did. Can anybody hear that? Worldliness is when you start taking the credit because you're so great. All right. Mark chapter 4. Watch this. Still talking about the word. Everybody say the word. The word is rocking. Mark chapter, what did I say? 4. Or what did I say? Mark. No, I want Mark chapter 4. Mark's account of the parable of the sower. Verse 13. Look at this. I'm going to do this quick and then we're going to try to go somewhere else. What kind of time are we looking at, Christian? Wow. Amazing. And he said unto them, Jesus, this is Jesus, the parable of the sower. Everybody say the sower. Matthew 13, Mark 4, and in Luke 8. I'm going to probably jump to a couple of them. And he said unto them, know ye not this parable? And how then will you know all parables? What Jesus is saying is, if you don't understand this parable, how are you going to understand any of the parables? Let me expand on that and say, how are you going to understand anything in the Word? Okay? That's big. Next verse. The sower soweth. The latest Christian book. The sower soweth what God told me. The sower soweth the word. Let me show it to you. We'll come right back here and jump over to Luke chapter 8, verse 11, I think. We'll see. Luke 8, 11. Now, this is Luke's account of the parable of the sower. Now, the parable is this. The seed is the word of God. Do you know if you take a seed, it will automatically produce, if it's in the right environment, soil, water, and sunlight. Did you know that? You don't have to concern yourself with the seed producing. What you need to make sure is that your heart is right, the soil's right, and that you get that you're allowing sunlight and water. Well, those are things. But I'm going to show you back to Mark 4:14. Watch this. This is so good. So good. The sower soweth the word. Next verse. And these are they by the wayside where the word is sown, but when they have heard, Satan cometh immediately, leave this verse up here, and taketh away that word which was sown in their hearts. Now let me say something to you. Matthew's account of this, in Matthew 13, verse 19, it says, when they hear the word of the kingdom, they hear the word, and they don't have understanding, Satan's able to steal that out of their heart. Once again, this is why we have to meditate on the word. We have to meditate. Listen, I am convinced people get bitter at God in their hearts because they don't know that God cannot violate His Word. He can't violate it. It's impossible. It's impossible. It's impossible. It's impossible. God can't violate it. It means every time I pray, the power of God's released. And I just got this attitude anymore. I'll pray for anything. I'll pray for a rock unless God says no. I'm serious. We need to be that way. You're all ministers. Why do we think Christ has taken up residence in the spirit of man, in our heart? Why do we think that? So we can get a holy buzz on Sunday and then go back to football on the other days? Nothing wrong with football. But I'm saying, no, so we can change the world. God's called you to change your world. Isn't that exciting?
Thank you.
Nah, I don't know about that. I'm not in the ministry. You are in the ministry. We're all in the ministry. And these are they by the wayside where the word is sown, but when they have heard, Satan cometh immediately, because of no understanding, Matthew 13:19, and taketh away the word that was sown in their hearts. Next verse. And these are they likewise which are sown on stony ground, who when they have heard the word, immediately receive it with gladness. How many people have we seen like that over the years? Man, I'm into this. Wow. Awesome. I remember one guy telling me, man, you don't know what's in you, man. Man, it's awesome. Powerful. He's been going a long time. I heard Andrew Womack say this. It was so powerful. He said, whenever I see somebody just real pumped up and fired up, my flags usually go up. Because a lot of times it's just emotional. Nothing wrong with emotions. That's cool. I mean, I like when you respond. I mean, grunt, do something. But you know what I know? The word of God is powerful. And I'm not apologizing for it. And I say, well, hope you got something. My, this is the eternal word of God. I mean, come on, Chris. All right. They immediately, their son is receive it with gladness. Next verse. And have no root in themselves. No root in themselves. In other words, it's always what so-and-so said. It doesn't get root in that person. Amen? Once it gets root in you, guess what? No one can take it from you. Amen. This is why people, you can live for years. If you don't do the word, which has to do with meditating and allowing God to put it in your heart and to show you, he'll give you the creative flair because it's a personal thing with you and God. But if you don't do that, that's why years and years and years people never seem to change. Because the word never gets root in them. I don't want you to be codependent upon me. I want you to have a relationship with God yourself.
Amen.
Because if you're codependent upon anybody, it's number one, it's unhealthy. We're interdependent, but not we're not independent. We're not codependent. We're to be interdependent. We need each other in that sense. But listen, I don't want your relationship with God to be through me or anybody else. It needs to be your relationship with God. And how is that? Through the Word of God.
Amen.
Never. I'm telling you guys, there's a lot of Christian books out there. Did you know that? And some are really good, but not all are. Let me show you this, and we'll come right back to Mark 4:17. Amplified, Ecclesiastes 12:12. I like good Christian books. I recommend them. We give them out. I believe in that. But I know a lot of times people's only relationship with God is through somebody's book or somebody's audio series. It's never with God himself. The Holy Spirit wants to guide you into the truth. He wants you to have... Somebody may say something. You may sit it down and begin to meditate and pray on it, but you got to see it in the Word. Guys, this is a word church. We are about the word. And any church that is not about, oh yeah, they quote verses too, but you got to be in the word. You got to be devouring the word. Thank God for word churches. All right, now watch this. But going further than the words, but back up one verse, because I want to get a running start here. The words of the wise are like prodding goads and firmly fixed in the mind like nails are the collected sayings which are given as proceeding from one shepherd. Next verse. But about going further than the words given by one shepherd, but about going further than the words that are given by one shepherd, my son, be warned. My son, be warned. You know what son? I heard a Hebrew expositor say this about the word son in the Old Testament Hebrew. One of the definitions is builder of the family name. How many know God wants you to build the family name? I just love that. Okay, but going further than the words given by one shepherd, Jesus, my son, be warned. Of making many books, there is no end. So do not believe everything you read. Can I give you an example? Okay, I will. I got a thing from somebody, not from the United States. And you know, if you're listening, please, I don't mean to be disrespectful to you, and that's not my goal, but I hear stuff, people say stuff all the time, and I thought, and said, isn't that a shame? Obama canceled the National Day of Prayer. And I told my wife, and I said, wow. And Jen goes, he can't do that. We got the Senate and the House, you can't do that. I thought, yeah, I come out to church today, and there's on the flyers, National Day of Prayer, Thursday, May the 5th. You can't believe everything you hear. My brother Steve books all these different bands in, and he says, people come and say, boy, they sound terrible. He goes, I'll go listen to them, they sound great. Or they'll say, man, they're really great. I go listen to them, they ain't no good. People say all kinds of things. Amen? That's my point. Now watch this. Of making many books, there is no end, so do not believe everything you read, and much study is a weariness of the flesh. He's talking about studying outside the Word of God. Hallelujah. I've been around for a few years in the body of Christ, and I can remember a lot of moves. Prayer Jabez, God Chaser. I can remember all these different moves that have come and gone. There may have been good things in them. I'm not minimizing that, but I'm telling you, so many times we get so caught up in the latest Christian fad. The key is to have a relationship with God yourself, because that's the only thing that's stable. Amen. All right, back to Mark chapter 4. Thank you. It is the only thing that's stable. Amen. Yep. Oh, glory to God. There's one more I might read of. Mark chapter 4. Verse 16 or 17? And in the same way, King James, please. Thank you. And these are likewise which are sown on stony ground, who when they have heard the word. Now, what is the ground? It's the heart. It's the heart. Now, watch this. Immediately receive it with gladness. Next verse. And they have no root in themselves, the Bible says. Now, watch this. And so endure but for a time. Afterward, when affliction or persecution arises, for their gifting's sake, for their talent's sake, for the word's sake. I'm going to drop something on you guys. It ain't about you. It's about the word. That's what I got. You know how arrogant it is for me to preach a message of the word of God and for me to apologize? You know what that shows? You focus more on your delivery than the word of God. Knock it off, Chris. I'm knocking it off. I've been meditating on that. I say, no, no more. This is the living, powerful word of God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Man, this will change your life if you let it get into your heart. The psalmist said in Psalm 119, verse 162, I rejoice at your word as one who finds great spoil or treasure, the New King James says. Do you rejoice at his word? See, here's the difference. Some people are saying, no, we just go by Jesus, the living word. No, Jesus himself used the written word. He did not depart from the written word. Whenever you separate the written word, scriptures, from the living word, Jesus, you are wide open for all kinds of deception. Anybody's word can come in there and say anything. You know, I've heard some people do symbolism, and man, this means that, and that means that, and I'm thinking, where's that at in the word? We've heard something. My wife looked at me and said, no, we didn't just hear that, did we? And the person made it sound like the Holy of Holies was in your genitals.
Okay.
Now that's beyond. I'm trying to be nice. That's not scriptural. That's not scriptural, okay? But there's no limit when you remove the word of God. Did you understand? This is why Satan hates the word. Now look, notice this. When affliction and persecution arises for the word's sake. Immediately, they're offended. It didn't say they gave up on God. It says they're offended. They lose their momentum. There's no drive. There's no excitement in the word of God. That's what happens. Why? Because, can I tell you something? You're in this world. You take a stand for God. If you don't run into the devil, it's because you're flowing with him. And if you take a stand for God, I can guarantee you, you're going to have some opposition.
Amen. That's right.
This world's a mess. Hallelujah. 2 minutes. Praise God. I wanted to, next week, guys, we may get into the sin unto death. I want to show you what the sin unto death is. I know what it is. It's not blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. That's a different one. We'll talk about that next week. You got to come back. Don't have time. I try not to talk too fast. I really do. Hallelujah. Have no root in themselves. Immediately they're offended. Next verse. And these are they which are sown among thorns. Once again, they hear the what? The word. Next verse. And the cares, the worries, the anxieties. Give me the amplified on this if you don't care. The cares, the anxieties, the worries of this world, the cares and anxieties of the world, and distractions of the age, I mean, there's some distractions out there. And the pleasure and delight in false glamour and deceitfulness of riches. Now this, well, that ain't me because I sure don't have enough money. If you're in America, you're rich. And if you're not, you can go get credit and be pretend you're rich. Amen? So that's all he's saying is when I let those things pull me away, there's nothing wrong. We're going to take a vacation. I'm excited about it. That's a good thing. But when my God is the next meal and the next this and the next that, there's something wrong in my heart. You know, my wife and I were texting. We were talking this morning about, well, we talked about going to pizza. We talked about this. And I told her, and I texted, it's only food. Who cares? Just food. It's about being with people. That's what makes it fun. Don't get me wrong, I like to eat. So the cares, this is what, and the anxieties of the world and distractions of the age, and the pleasure and delight and false glamour and deceitfulness of riches, and the craving and passionate desire for other things creep in. See, this is why we abstain from fleshly lust. Not because God will reject us, because they war against our soul. And we become more consumed with other things. I like a lot of things, but man, I've noticed, man, I'll hear one song and that thing's going on in my brain. You know, this is, we watch a documentary on Michael Jackson. And I'm walking around singing, Billie Jean. I'm trying to do all this stuff. I mean, I'm thinking, I like that bass. But I'm saying, my point, there's nothing wrong with that, but I don't want my focus to be, I want it to be on Him. Because if I keep my imagination and my mind stayed upon Him, I'm going to experience perfect peace. I'm going to be trusting in God. And God's going to be able to flow through me. God's never the variable. God's already released everything, guys. We're going to get into that next week. When you understand covenant, you begin to understand blood covenant. I can't get away from it. It is all over the place. And I'm going to show you how people deny the blood without even knowing they're denying the blood. The blood, the life is in the blood, guys. The life is in the blood of Jesus. And that's why Peter says it's precious blood. Precious blood. Amen. So once they creep in and they choke, oh, look at this. These things, cares of this world, deceitfulness of riches, lust of other things, they creep in. Creep in. Creep in. Creep in. That's why we don't let up. You know, I know a constrictor snake, when the prey lets up a breath, the coil gets tighter. So we're not interested in that. Amen? They creep in and they choke and suffocate the word. And it becomes fruitless. Now back to the King James, verse 20. I'm just going to bust through these quick and we'll be done. And these are they which are sown on good ground. Luke's account says in verse Luke 8:15, I believe it is, in a good and honest heart. In fact, let's go to Luke's account. Luke 8:15. I want you to see this one. This is so good. Luke 8:15. And that on good ground are they which in an honest and good heart, watch this, having heard the word, keep it, guard it, protect it, and bring forth fruit quickly. With endurance, hupomene, with patience, with patience. That's why I say, if you don't quit, you can't lose. The devil knows that. See, if I'm all hooked to my feelings instead of the Word of God, I guarantee I'm going to have some negative feelings. We all do. Well, what's the use? That's exactly where the enemy wants you. When you begin to value the Word of God, when you get to begin to esteem the Word of God above everything else. In fact, Jesus is called the Word. Did you know that?
Hello.
Jesus is the Word, the living Word.
Yes.
But He's connected directly to the Scriptures, the written Word. They're not separate. They're one. In fact, that's all legalism is. Legalism comes about because people remove Jesus from the Scriptures. And Jesus said that in John 5:39. He said, search the Scriptures, for in them you think you have life, and they testify of me, the Scriptures, but you won't come to me that you might have life. The written word points to the living word. And if we will go to Jesus through the written word, we'll see the living word, and we'll see the living word in our life. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God activated in their life.
Amen.
Praise God. Give the Lord a hand.